Now let's do a couple of examples where we will use instantaneous center of zero velocity method to solve for velocities. Like I said before, you cannot use the instantaneous center method of zero velocity to do acceleration analysis. So let me write that down in red. Do not use instantaneous center of zero velocity method to solve for acceleration. Okay, because instantaneous center of zero velocity is not necessarily the center of zero acceleration as well. Okay, all right, so now let's do a couple of examples. So this is a mechanism which is also actually a four bar mechanism. It's called a double slider mechanism. So in this case, when this slider is pushed down this way, this slider would be pushed in this direction. Okay, so this slider, let's call it P1, is constrained to slide up and down, while this slider P2 is constrained to slide in the horizontal direction. So if P1 comes down, then P2 has to move to the right, and they're connected by this connecting rod, which is shown right over here. Okay, so let's say I give you the velocity of the slider 1 as VP1, all right? And I ask you, tell me what is the velocity of the slider 2, as well as what is the angular velocity of the connecting rod, right? So we have three rigid bodies that are moving over here. If you look at their motion, you can clearly see that P1 and P2 are doing translation, and the connecting rod is doing general planar motion, right? So we want to use instantaneous center of zero velocity method to solve for angular velocity of the connecting rod, as well as the velocity of slider 2, which is VP2, okay? So first of all, we have to locate the instantaneous center of zero velocity for every rigid body over here, okay? So where is the center of rotation at this particular instant? For P1, it's at infinity, right? Because it's doing translation. Same thing with the P2. All right, what about connecting rod? To locate the instantaneous center of zero velocity for the connecting rod, we have to know the velocity direction of two points on this rigid body, okay? Which we know. So velocity direction of P1 is shown is exactly this way. Velocity direction of this point, which is same as the velocity of the point P2 of the slider 2, is going to be this way, right? Okay, those are the two velocity directions. So all we have to do now is draw perpendiculars to the velocity direction, okay? Now remember, you always draw perpendiculars to the velocity direction. You do not extend the velocity direction themselves and intersect them to find the distance in the center of zero velocity, okay? So let's draw perpendiculars. So perpendicular to VP1 is this way, perpendicular to VP2 is this way. This is where they intersect. So that is the point of rotation at this instant, okay? All right, so that's good. So let's say this length is L, this angle is theta. Okay, so now we can write velocity of P1 equal to, this is L, so this is L cosine theta. So OP1 times omega, right? Because this connecting rod is rotating about 0.0 at this particular instant. So we can write velocity P1 equal to the distance from O to P1 times omega. And that right away gives you the omega. So that's VP1 over OP1, which is L cosine theta, right? It gives you the angular velocity. And velocity of P2 would be equal to the perpendicular distance from O to P2, which is L sine theta times omega. And that would be L sine theta times VP1 over L cosine theta. L cancels, so we get VP1 times 10 theta. And that is velocity of P2. You see, you can solve this problem far more simply rather than using the vector equation if you use instantaneous center of zero velocity method, right? Okay, let's look at another example. So let's say we have one link given like this, a connecting rod like this, and you know, another length given like this. Okay, I'm just making it up, all right? Okay, so let's say this is making an angle 45 degree. This is length L, this is length L, and this is 2L, all right? I'm just, you know, going to create this. So this is 0.02, 0.04, that's A and B. And you are given the angular velocity of O2A, let's say that's omega 2. And you have to find the angular velocity of AB and angular velocity of O4B, okay? All right, so that's the problem. Now, of course, you can solve this problem using vector equations that we've discussed before. We know our common points, we have to write their velocities and so on, right? Okay, so let's try to locate the instantaneous center of zero velocity for link AB. Because for O4B and O2A, we know their point of rotation directly, O2 and O4. So to locate the instantaneous center of zero velocity for AB, we have to show the velocity addition of two points. Now we know the velocity addition of point A, it's going to be downward, because if you look at the link O2A, link O2A is moving in the clockwise direction, the velocity addition of A has to be perpendicular to the line O2A, so we get the velocity addition of A that way, right? Okay, then we also know the velocity addition of point B, because point B is rotating in a circular path about 0.04, right? So velocity addition of B has to be perpendicular to O4B. Okay, which direction would that be? Well, perpendicular to this is this line, right? Is this line. Is the velocity addition of B this way or is it this way? We don't know that, right? But we can figure it out. But we do know that it is actually along this line, right? Okay, so we know that this is the line for the velocity addition. This is the velocity addition for point A. To locate the instantaneous center of zero velocity for AB, we have to draw their perpendiculars. So let's draw the perpendiculars. I'm going to choose a different color for that. So what is a perpendicular line for VA? Is this line, right? What is a perpendicular line for the velocity addition of point B? It is this line, which is same as actually O4B. This is where they intersect. So that is the point of rotation for AB at this particular instant. Okay, all right. So now you could, if you wanted, if let's say this was a little bit confusing to you, what you could do is at this instant, you could just look at AB, the rigid body, all by itself, right? So let's just draw this all by itself, AB here. Okay. And what this is saying is that AB, the connecting rod, at this particular instant, seems to be rotating about 0.0. Okay, only at this instant, remember. So where is that point? So that point is certain distance away horizontally from here and going that way, right? This is where it is. Okay, so at this particular instant, AB seems to be rotating about 0.0. So it's almost as if you could put a fixed hinge over here and the AB is rotating about this 0.0, right? And what do we know about velocity point A? Velocity of the point A is actually known to us. Velocity of the point A is given to us. What is velocity of A? Velocity of A is equal to L times omega 2. That's this magnitude, right? And it's pointing that way. So now you can see clearly just from this that the AB is going to be rotating in the counterclockwise direction. Why? Because the point A is going downward, right, this way, which means that this can happen only if AB was rotating this way, right? So that tells you that omega AB is counterclockwise, right? Okay, B, as a result now, will be pointing this way. This is the perpendicular, right? Will be pointing this way. It doesn't look nice, so I'm going to just draw this, to erase this and do it again. So this is the perpendicular direction for velocity of B. Right, so over here there was this question which way it was pointing, the towards the left, towards the right, but now we know for sure the moment we locate the instantaneous center that velocity of the B has to be this way. Okay, now what is velocity of A equal to? Velocity of A is equal to L omega 2 from the perspective of the crank O2A, but it is also equal to, from the perspective of the connecting rod, OA times the omega 3, which is the angular velocity of the connecting rod. But what is OA? OA is this length here, right? This is 45, this is 45, so this will be 2L. So that's 2L times omega 3. So omega 3 is equal to omega 2 over 2. Right away, you get that. Okay, so what we have found so far is that if we know the angular velocity of the link O2A, which is omega 2, we can find the angular velocity of the connecting rod, which is omega 3. So what remains to be done is to find the angular velocity of the last length, which is O4B, right? And we're saying its angular velocity is omega 4. So this is actually not omega 3, this is omega 4, right? This is omega 4. So omega 4 is something that we need to find now, right? Now, B is a common point between O4B as well as the connecting rod AB. We just found something about the velocity of B because we know the angular velocity of AB. So what can we say about velocity of B? Velocity of B is equal to OB times omega 3 from the perspective of connecting rod. And OB is 2L, so that's, this is 45, so that's 2L times root 2 times omega 3. And omega 3 is known, so we can write that to L root 2 times omega 2 over 2. Too many 2s, let's cancel them. We get L times omega 2 times root 2. And that's velocity of B. That's good. Now let's focus on the last link, O4B. For O4B, what is velocity of B? Velocity of B is equal to L times omega 4. And that we can equate with this. So we get this times this. L cancels. So omega 4 is equal to omega 2 times root 2. That's it. So it's really that simple to solve for velocities using instantaneous center method. Now the only thing that is remaining to find is what is the direction of rotation of O4B. And that's easy to find too, because we can see that the velocity of the point B is going this way, right? And that is the velocity of the point B for O4B as well, which means that O4B has to rotate in the counterclockwise direction. So if you were to write it completely in terms of vectors, you would write this as omega 4 vector omega 2 root 2 positive k hat. And you would do the same thing for the other angular velocities.